Hello, I welcome you all in this course on mechanical measurement systems, and today we will discuss about the thermophysical property measurement. And the topics to be covered in today's lecture are measurement of thermal conductivity, measurement of viscosity, measurement of humidity, and measurement of heat flux. So we shall start with the measurement of thermal conductivity. Say, in most of the heat transfer calculations, we often do the energy balance, right? And thermal conductivity is a property of any substance which is indicative of the heat transmission through conduction, because there are three modes of heat transfer: conduction, convection, and radiation. And it is a transport property also, because it is indicative of the transportation of energy in a solid, liquid, or gas, right? So it is a transport property, and especially in the case of conduction heat transfer, in the case of conduction heat transfer, this property becomes very important, because it shows how fast heat can be transmitted through a solid object, right? And it is, as we know, the heat transfer through conduction, in unidirectional heat transfer through conduction in any slab, is denoted by Q is equal to minus K A delta T by delta X. X is the thickness of the slab, and delta T is the temperature difference, that is T2 minus T1. And because the heat transmission is taking place in this direction, so that is why the T2 is always less than T1. Because heat itself is defined as the energy in transition by virtue of temperature difference. So T1 is always higher than T2, so delta T is T2 minus T1, so it will be a negative value, and this negative will be cancelled out, and A is the cross section area through which the heat transmission is taking place. Now here we have to find the heat transfer. Here we have to find thermal conductivity of this material. So what we can do, we can take one slab. We can take one slab, and in this slab, we can take one slab, right? And heat, this side is heated, and heat transmission takes place Q. Thickness of the slab is known, X. Temperature on the both sides we can measure by T1 and T2. And this is a constant heat flux, right? So, this is a constant heat flux. So, Q is measured, if it is electrically heated or the joules heating, then it is going to be Vi. I is the current in the wire, and the V is the potential difference. And this heat transmission is taking place in this direction, and we can measure that, or we can determine, not measure, Q is equal to minus K A delta T by delta X. Here delta T by delta X is known to us, cross section area is known to us, and we can simply determine the value of K. The unit of K is, in SI unit, is watt per meter Kelvin. Now here there is a problem. The problem is heat transmission, because the surrounding, it is surrounded by the air, so heat transmission will also take place in this direction. There may not be uniform heating of the plate, right? So, an apparatus has been designed, it is known as guard heater type of thermal conductivity measurement system. So, in this system, there is a thin plate, and on the both sides, there are guard heaters. Because even if we insulate the plate, even if we insulate this bare plate, in that case also, suppose both sides are insulated. If both sides are insulated, in that case also, the temperature field will be developed, especially in the case when this is also an insulating material. a temperature field will be developed. So, in order to avoid this, guard heaters are used. Temperature of guard heaters is the temperature of this plate. So, there is no heat transmission in this direction, in the lateral directions, right? And then the guard plate heater is sandwiched between the sample at the top and at the bottom, right? And this sample is jacketed and cooling water is circulated in the jacket. Cooling water coming in and then cooling water is going out. Here this side also it is jacketed. So cooling water is coming in and the cooling water is going out, and heat taken away by the cooling water is the heat transmission. Geometry of the test section is known to us, right? And this is how we can calculate the value of thermal conductivity. That is for the solids. And this is the apparatus is known as guard plate heaters type of apparatus, and it is very popular and it is a very, I mean, cost effective instrument for determining the thermal conductivity of the solids. For conducting material, there is another method of cylinders. In this case, suppose I want to have the thermal conductivity of copper or any conductive material. So, for that purpose, cylinders are used. There are two cylinders. In contact with each other, right? This cylinder is connected to the heat source, TH, is connected to heat source at temperature TH, or let us say heat source. And the bottom one is connected to heat sink. Now, when this side is connected to heat source, and they are identical in dimensions. So, when they are connected in series with the heat source and the heat sink, the heat will flow in this direction. And this arrangement is insulated so that there is no radial heat transfer. The entire arrangement is insulated, so that there is no radial heat transfer, okay? And thermocouples are fixed on the surface. Right? And now heat transmission takes place in this direction and thermocouple reading is taken. I mean, this is, let us say, T1, T2, T3, T4, T5, T6, or we can have more number of thermocouples. Right. Now, heat transmission is equal to minus Ka delta T by delta X. The distance between these thermocouples is also noted. So, Q is equal to Ka delta T minus delta X, and these two cylinders, they are connected in series, right? So, that is going to be 1 is equal to minus, so this is, let us say, K1 and this is K2, A delta T by delta X. Area is same, only delta T by delta X 1 and delta T by delta X 2, right? So, we will get K1 delta T by delta X 1 is equal to K2 delta T by delta X 2. Now, here K1 is known. This cylinder is of known thermal conductivity or reference cylinder, right? So, this is known to us. This we have measured delta T by delta X because we have temperature at different locations. So, we can always calculate delta T by delta X. Delta T by delta X for second cylinder is also known. So, we can easily find the value of unknown thermal conductivity, right? So this is normally used for finding out the thermal conductivity of conductive material. Now, thermal conductivity of liquid and gases. In order to find the thermal conductivity of the liquids, two-cylinder method is used. There are two cylinders. Cylinder one. This is one cylinder, right? And inside that there is another cylinder. Right. From the top, they are insulated. They are insulated at the top. So, insulation is here. Both the cylinders are insulated, right? And there is a gap between the inner wall of the outer cylinder and outer wall of inner cylinder. Now, this gap is very small. The length we can take these cylinders is approximately 5 inches of the height, and the diameter of inner cylinder is approximately 1.5 inch. It 1.5 inch comes around to be 38 mm, right? And the gap is this gap between the inner wall of the outer cylinder and outer wall of inner cylinder is 0.025 inch or it comes 0.625 mm, right? So, these are the approximate dimensions. They may vary also. I mean, as a designer, you can vary these dimensions as well. They are not to be followed very strictly. So, when the liquid is filled in this column, right? And in the center, there is a heater. Radial heat transfer takes place. Now, for the cylinders, if the radial heat transfer is taking place, then we have the equation for the radial heat transfer in the cylinder. That is, Q is the heat transmission, is equal to 2 pi K L T2 minus T1 divided by natural log of R2 by R1. So, these are the 2 pi K. K has to be found out. Q is constant heat flux or constant heating, that we know from VVA, heating through this wire. Length is, we know the length. Temperature difference can be measured with the help of thermocouples fixing at these places. That is the temperature difference between the thin layer of fluid. And then dimensions, these dimensions are also known to us. So, this is another method of finding out, I think this is the first one. So, this is the method for finding out the thermal conductivity of liquids, and in the gases also this can be used, right? There is another method for finding out the thermal conductivity of the gases with a guarded heater. So, in the guarded heater, there is an emitter. And concentric to the emitter, there is a heater, and it is enveloped with a receiver. This is a receiver. An emitter has both sides, the guarded heater. The purpose of the guarded heater is that there is no transmission of heat in axial direction. So, there is always transmission of heat in the radial direction. This is emitter and this is receiver. And now, we have the geometry of this, the length of this, height of this, heater is approximately 125 millimeters, 5 inches. So, 5 inches comes around 125 millimeters. Thickness T is 1 millimeter, temperature difference of the order of 5 to 10 degree centigrade is maintained. Because if you maintain lower temperature, the uncertainty in the measurement will be high. Because, for example, a thermocouple which has an accuracy of 0.1 degree centigrade. Suppose I am measuring the temperature of the order of 1 degree. So, if I am measuring the temperature of the order of 1 degree, the uncertainty in the measurement is going to be 10%. If I am measuring temperature 10 degree, the uncertainty in the measurement is going to be 1%. Right. So, that is why in order to reduce the error in the measurement, this temperature difference is maintained and emitter emits the radiation, the heat, and through conduction is go to the receiver, right, and using the same formula we use for the cylinders, here the thermal conductivity is determined. Now, after thermal conductivity, we will take up the viscosity, how to measure the viscosity of the fluid, because in heat transfer and fluid flow, the determination of the viscosity is equally important. So, we will take up another thermophysical property of the fluid which is widely used in fluid mechanics and heat transfer, that is viscosity. Right? Viscosity in SI unit, it is denoted by Pascal second, or it is Newton per meter square second. Okay. Now, for finding out the viscosity, we know the relation, shearing stress is equal to mu du by dy. Right. Now, if we take this du by dy, suppose there are two plates separated by a very small distance and the gap is filled with some fluid, right. If this plate is stationary and this is moving with a certain velocity u in this direction. So, velocity vector is going to be like this, right. And if the distance between these two plates is y, then du by dy is going to be u by b. B is the distance between these two plates, right. And regarding the shearing stress, how much force is exerted in this direction divided by the area of this plate, that will give the shearing stress. So, through this also we can find the value of viscosity of the fluid. But there is a little more sophisticated method for finding out the viscosity of the fluid. In this case, two cylinders are taken. One is fixed, the inner cylinder is fixed, and outer rotates with certain RPM. And this gap is filled with fluid for which the viscosity has to be found out. Okay. And this cylinder is, there is a mechanism to find the torque developed in this cylinder by the movement of or torque transmission to this cylinder by virtue of rotation of this cylinder. Okay. Now, the inside radius, suppose it is R1 and the outer radius is R2, and the thickness of this or the gap between these two is B. Fine. In this case, du by dy, the velocity gradient is going to be R2 omega by B, because this cylinder is stationary and that is moving with certain rotational speed. So, when it is moving with certain rotational speed, so linear velocity is going to be R2 omega, and B divided by B will give us du by dy. Okay. Then torque. Torque is force into distance x. Now, torque here. So, torque is force. Force is shearing stress multiplied by the surface area. So, shearing stress is tau, surface area is 2 pi r1 l. right? And X is R1, right? So it comes to be tau into 2 pi R1 square L. L is the length of the cylinder. And here, from here we can get the value of tau is equal to T by 2 pi R1 square L. Fine. And now we have the value of tau, we have the value of du by dy, right? So we can get the value of mu, it is going to be TB divided by 2 pi R1 square R2 L omega. So this is going to be the value of viscosity of the fluid. Now here we have not taken into account the viscous force or the viscosity of the fluid which is at the bottom of the cylinder. We have taken only the shearing effect of the fluid which is surrounding the cylinder, not at the bottom of the cylinder. So for this purpose, if we take this also into account, then final expression for torque can be written as mu pi omega R1 square by 2a plus 2l R2 by b. And from here, we can find the value of mu. Now, for finding out the viscosity of the fluid, there is a very popular device which is known as Seebald viscosity meter. Seebald viscosity meter is a device, and it is nothing but a vessel of a fixed geometry. Vessel of fixed geometry. The volume of this vessel is 60 mL. The entire volume of this vessel is 60 mL. This diameter is 2.975 centimeters. Height, this is, I will take some other. Height, this is 8.8 centimeter. Okay, diameter height. Okay, the entire height is 12.5 centimeter. They are all fixed dimensions. Seebald viscometer has all fixed dimensions. Volume is 60 centimeter cube. 60. This is centimeter cube, 60 cc, and this height, this is nozzle, this height is 1.225 centimeters. Diameter of this is 0.1765 centimeters. So all dimensions are fixed here. What is left? Yes, this is 0.9 centimeters, and this height is 2.46 centimeters. The drawing, this figure may not be having the same proportion in the dimensions, but these are the salient dimensions of this tube for used for viscosity measurement, and this is house like this, and this height is 8.65 centimeters. This is 8.65 centimeters. So everything is fixed here. So there is no flexibility. Now Any fluid for which the viscosity is required to be measured will be filled here. This opening will be, this wall will be opened, and time will be noted, how much time it is taking to drain off the vessel. And there is a relation that kinematic viscosity is equal to C1T plus C2 divided by T, where C1 is equal to 0.00 or we can write is equal to 0.00237 T. So, and this is C2 is minus 1.93 divided by T multiplied by 10 to power minus 3 feet square per second, because it was, I mean, this is very old device, and that time inch pond system was used for the measurement. So, these are the constants for finding out the kinematic viscosity of the fluid. And 1 feet square per second is equal to 9.2903 into 10 to power minus 2 meter square per second, or 929.03 strokes, because viscosity is also expressed in terms of strokes. So, 1 centistroke consists of 100 strokes. So, these are 929.03 strokes, and 1 centistroke consists of, so 1 feet per square second is 929.03 into 10 to power minus 2 meter square per second, and it is going to be equal to 929.03 strokes, right. Now, this strokes and 1 stroke consists of 100 centistrokes, right. So, this is how the viscosity, kinematic viscosity can be measured with the help of Sebald viscometer. And now, we will go for another very important measurement, which is really important for the mechanical engineers, that is humidity measurement. So, humidity measurement, there are two types of humidities. One is relative humidity. It is denoted by phi. Now, relative humidity is mass of the water vapor in the air divided by mass of the water vapor in saturated air, mass of the water vapor in saturated air, right. So, it is PV over RT, and this is PVSV over RT. Temperature is constant and volume is constant, so they will be cancelled out. So, it is going to be PV by PVS. This is relative humidity. Another is specific humidity. Specific humidity is equal to mass of mass of water vapor and mass of the water vapor and mass of dry air. And mass of the vapor and mass of the air can be again measured by, now P, pressure is same, PV, V divided by R water, and T divided by PA, V R air, and T. And this finally results in, because there, I mean, gas constant for water vapor and gas constant for air, right. If we take them into the account, then it comes out to be 0.662 PV by P minus PV. If we consider that the sample of air consists of only vapor and air. Now, how to calculate the humidity? For calculation of the humidity, there is a hygrometer. Hygrometer has dry bulb and the wet bulb. So, bulb is covered with a wick or a cold or wet cloth, and when the humidity in the air is low, the evaporation is high. When evaporation is high, suppose it is showing some temperature T degree centigrade, that is dry bulb temperature, the normal temperature in the room. When on the bulb, when evaporation takes place, the cooling of this bulb takes place and there is a dip in temperature. Lower the humidity of air, higher is the dip. So, there is a relation for finding out the PV, that is P wet bulb minus P minus PS wet bulb, T dry bulb minus T wet bulb divided by KW minus T wet bulb. Right. Now, KW is 2800 when T is in Fahrenheit and it is 1537.8 when T is in degree centigrade. Once we have the value of PV with us, then easily we can find the specific humidity, because it is 662 PV by P minus PV. So, total pressure of the air is known, PV is known, that is how we can calculate the value of specific heat. That is how we calculate the value of specific humidity of the air. Now, last one is heat flux. The measurement of heat flux Now, heat flux is required. Sometimes, say, we can always measure the heat flux as Q by A, right? But sometimes heat flux is directly required to be measured. And for this purpose, heat flux sensors are used. For example, suppose I want to have heat transmission to the walls in case of fire. So, in case of fire, if I want to have heat transfer to the wall, because in that case, I need heat flux meter. It will be difficult to calculate the heat transfer and then divide it by the cross section area. So, at different locations in the room, if I want to have heat flux in this room, in case of fire, I will embed heat flux sensors at different walls or in the ceiling of the room, and heat flux, that is how the heat flux can be calculated. Now, for the finding out the heat flux, there is a slug sensor type of heat flux, This slug sensor type of heat flux is embedded in the wall. And a thermocouple is provided. When the heat is coming in, that is Q. Right? And Q is, or let us say heat flux, Q is minus K dT by dx. Now, in this slug sensor, when heat is transmitted, right, energy will be stored in it and temperature will start increasing. Energy is stored Q, it is not the heat transfer rate, it is energy only, joules or in kilojoules. It is m c delta T, right. Now, I want to have heat flux. So, it has to be divided by cross section area. So, Q by A is equal to m c by A delta T. Now, I want to have rate of heat transfer, that is engineering heat transfer. So, for in order to find the rate of heat transfer, or the Q m c by A dT by dT. Now, from this thermocouple, we will measure this value dT by dT, and ultimately which will give us the heat flux falling on this wall. But this type of heat flux, if there is a steady state, it is difficult to calculate the heat flux. It can give the heat flux only in the transient state, first of all. Second thing is, the heat transfer characteristic of all the entire object is changed, because this is an obstruction type of heat flux measuring device. So it is possible that if the surrounding wall is an insulating material, the entire heat will like to go through this sensor only, right? So the heat transfer characteristics or transmission characteristics of the surrounding wall is also changed by using this slug type of heat exchange, this heat flux meter. And the last one is Gordon heat flux. Gordon type of heat flux. In Gordon type of heat flux, the heat flux meter is embedded in the wall. It is a constant end surface, right? A copper wire is fixed here, and this is all copper. This is all copper, right? And one copper wire is fixed here, right? And when the heat comes in this direction, the transmission of the heat in the radial direction is measured, right? This flux meter is accurate, and it can measure heat flux up to the 150 kilowatt per meter square of the order of this order. Only heat loss is radiation from this side, radiation heat transmission on the back side of the plate, and that has to be taken into account. Otherwise, this type of meter is quite suitable, and it is frequently used for heat flux measurement of any object, or heat flux measurement falling on any object. So this is all for today. Thank you very much. In the next lecture, we will start with the flow visualization techniques.